I felt inspired to come out to Crestbrookdale this morning and make a video as a bit of an antidote to the insanity which is currently unfolding in Gaza and Israel, and filling the newspapers, filling social media. And apart from one explanatory video which Max Egan made, which I felt was very informative if you're not aware of the history and skullduggery that's gone on in the past, I think it's about a 1 hour kind of commentary and almost like a documentary, infomentary, by Max Egan is well worth a watch if you just want to get up to speed with what's behind the current conflict. And of course, my heart goes out to everyone involved. I'm not particularly interested in taking sides. I'm on the side of peace, I'm on the side of love, and I'm on the side of awakening consciousness. And just zooming out from the detail and the horror of what's unfolding, it seems to me that there are certain powers, shall we call them, behind this conflict who are absolutely intent on creating as much dissonance in the grid as possible. Because of course the false matrix depends on chaos and fear and anger. It's actually made, it's fabricated through chaos, fear, anger, judgment, criticism, all those lower vibrational emotions, tools. And, you know, as human beings, being highly traumatized ourselves, and I guess most of us have not been on any kind of life healing journey, so most of us are simply coping with the trauma of our childhood and so on. What that means is it makes us very easy to trigger. And the three triggers are, of course, fight, flight, and freeze. And any time that we feel strongly triggered in any three of those directions, so the fight response, which is typically rooted in anger, or the flight response, which is typically rooted in fear, or the freeze response, which is really about numbing and numbing out, which is a big one, just to numb the pain with whatever is your favorite resource. I've just finished writing Liberation. It's actually at the publishers at the moment. We're in draft stage, so it's coming up. They promised me by the end of this month. So those of you who pre-ordered Liberation will be receiving it soon. It has been a difficult birth. It's been a 9-month period since I announced it at Imbolc in early February. So here we are, getting on for 9 months and expecting the birth any minute. But I write in Liberation about resources and actually how important they are in trauma healing. And Dr. Gabor Mate wrote a whole book called In the Realm of Hungry Ghosts, which is about honouring addictions and, you know, even heroin or methadone addicts. You know, it's those substances which have actually kept people alive, because a lot of people, without some way of coping, would probably end it. So honour your resources until such time as you can find the strength to embark on the healing journey, where you can really go to the root of the trauma. And it's the root of the trauma which is creating that need to salve, to soothe. So of course, zooming back to what's going on in Gaza and Israel, it's hugely triggering. And of course, if you've had any conflict in your past, in your childhood, if you have any trauma, then it's going to be resurrecting a lot of those feelings. And it may be feelings of anger towards the aggressors, whoever you may perceive the aggressors to be. And to be honest, who actually knows who the aggressors are in truth? I mean, we can only really go by what we're told by the mainstream media. And of course, who owns the mainstream media? So it was actually interesting. I don't buy the newspapers, the snooze papers. I haven't bought any newspapers for the longest time. I just don't consume mainstream media if I can help it. I mean, I do occasionally tune in to Radio 4 just to listen to what's being pumped out sometimes. But I tend to not go into that world on the whole, because I just know how much it lowers my vibration, and that's why I tend to spend a lot of time out in nature, out here at Crestbrook Dale or out in Bakewell walking Kobe, because it is so soothing for the soul. And but anyway, back to what I was saying. But I do sometimes, when I'm in the co-op in Bakewell, I will just stop by the newspapers and just have a look at what's on the front pages. What are the headlines screaming at us at the moment? And it was quite interesting because there was a story, I think it was on the front page of the Times yesterday, or may have been the day before, and it was basically a picture of a family who had been on a kibbutz. This was the story, so I haven't verified it for myself, but the story was basically a picture of British husband and wife and their two kids who had been on a kibbutz in Israel and who had been murdered by Hamas. At least that was the story. And you know, it's obviously, it's a tragedy, but I did, I always kind of just pause and I observe whatever I'm seeing, and I kind of zoom back from it, and I just think to myself, that's an interesting picture, because assume me and my family had been murdered on a kibbutz in Israel. Made me jump.
Morning.
Hi. There's a jogger going by. Firstly, how quickly would anyone find out about it? And secondly, how easy would it be for a newspaper to find out about it and to find a picture like that, so beautifully posed? And, you know, I'm just thinking of there's family pictures of me, but me and my boys, for example. But how easy would it be for someone like the Times to find that and to publish it on the front page of the newspaper, literally within hours of a conflict, presuming that let's say it was published yesterday. In fact, I'm pretty sure it was the day before. So that newspaper would have gone to print on Sunday night, because it's now Wednesday. Yesterday was Tuesday. So the newspaper would have gone to print on Sunday. And the conflict, as I understand it, started on Saturday, Sunday. That's very quick. I'm not saying it's impossible, but you have to pause and think, because it was a powerful PR pick, which basically a picture designed to win the hearts and the minds of the ordinary British people who can identify with that image, that happy family image. So I'm always conscious of what we're being presented with by the media. When I was tuning into Radio 4, and I think that was on Monday morning, because I was driving my son Jack back to his indoctrination camp. I mean, public school. He's now at a weekly boarder at a public school. not my idea, but he really wanted to do it and he had the opportunity. Yeah, I thought I'll just, as I'm in the car, it's drive time, I'll just tune in to what Radio 4 is dishing up. And of course, sounds of bombs and screaming and missiles and frantic correspondents, BBC correspondents based in Tel Aviv or wherever, you know, drama. And I'm not saying that the drama doesn't exist, but it's very easy to get drawn into the story, into the false matrix, into the fear, and also to get drawn into taking sides. So bringing peace into the situation by coming out to Crestbrook Dale, and it's very beautiful here, and a bit like most of the world, 99% of the time there's absolute peace here in Crestbrook Dale, and on the planet 99% of the people and the places live in peace and everyone gets on. And then boom, occasionally a small number of people ruin it for everyone, and ruin it by design, because they have an agenda and a point to make, and they believe that violence and destruction is the only way, is the only language that they know. So of course here at Crestbrook Dale, I would be lying if I said that there hadn't been any conflict here, but we have always, our community has always taken the view that we should just stand strong in our sovereign power, with a very strong no to all those who would bully and intimidate and use violence and similar tactics to try to create fear and division. And some people have fallen for those tactics, but the core of our community has actually been really bonded and is very steadfast, and has found a lot of unity and love and support for one another as we have dealt with some quite challenging times. So maybe this is the bigger teaching with all of this horror and the dissonance being pumped out by the false matrix. Because if the false matrix depends on chaos and fear and anger for its very survival, then rather than feeding that, surely it's a far better antidote to offer the reverse, and to keep offering up resonance and peace and prayers and calm and visioning a future where we can all live in harmony and we can find a way to coexist without things descending into conflict and war. So that's very much where we have been holding the space, and a big part of that, and it sounds counterintuitive and kind of bonkers, but a big part of that has been through music. And this, the great gift in our community, I have to say, is Mog, who brought a lot of music in throughout the whole journey. And she was part of our community. She turned up in 2021 when we were looking at acquiring Fallinge Farm. She actually made a whole album, in fact, two whole albums of all the songs she wrote, which were inspired by our journey together. The latest, which is called Love, which was released in February 2023, earlier this year. And so she's brought a huge amount of resonance, and she was the one who encouraged Angela and I to join morning mantras. So every morning, 6 days a week, well, most mornings, pretty much every day, we sit just online and just chant three mantras every morning with Lucidia and Raphael from 9 a.m. to 9:40. And it's just a beautiful practice. And of course, John, who is now a trustee of Crestbrookdale, he's visited here practically every weekend since we acquired the land. He absolutely loves it here. His Mars is in Taurus. He's like a real earth, really, really connected to the earth. But he was a guitarist in a band for, I think, 19 years. He was a bass guitarist. And he is absolutely, he loves music. You might have seen my Yoko and John video, which I filmed of us in the forest singing our little rendition of Waves Are Coming In. And yeah, you know, no attachment to, like, singing to bless, not to impress, shall we put it like that. I mean, I'm not a great singer. I'm more of a speaker than a singer. But I would love to be able to sing, but I listen to people like Lucidia and Mog, and wow, just so incredible to hear their voices, their angelic voices. So resonance is a huge antidote to dissonance. And I know a lot of people have been sharing an amazing choir singing a song about unity, which has been circulating, which I think was filmed a few years ago, but a very super powerful song about peace. So I do feel that it's really important, more important than ever, for us to recognise all the conflict which is unfolding in our world, whether that's out there somewhere on the other side of the planet or in the Middle East or in Ukraine and Russia or wherever the latest conflict, wherever the lens of the camera is pointing. You know, sorry, that's a Masonic symbol, isn't it? But that is, it is it, isn't it? It's the, where is the lens? Where are they directing our eye to focus on? You know, where is the lens pointing? Oh, look over here. Look, there's the conflict. Look, isn't it terrible? Look at this, look at this, look at this. And the truth is that 99% of the people and the places in the world are at peace. So that's why it's really important to get that balance to come out into nature. And if there is any conflict in your world, in your life, to fully feel that, I mean, some of the things that have happened here are very, when I feel into them, it is reminiscent of my childhood, actually, where I had three older brothers and anything nice I had, they used to just smash up, you know. And, you know, it's like nothing was kind of safe. And so just really, as my adult self, really tuning into that kind of despair as a young girl of not being able to have anything without fear of it being destroyed, or the tail of my basil brush being ripped off, or the hair being cut off my new doll, you know, all these things. You know, kind of violations, boundary violations is what you would call them in trauma healing. That's why it's interesting. I'm just standing here by the boundary. We've put this gate here because where I'm standing is not a public footpath, and it felt important just to. And we knew people were walking through here. I guess it's There is a right to roam on this land, but this is where it ends. So there is no public footpath through here, but of course people are using it as such. And it's a violation. It's a violation of a boundary. You know, it's like, would you walk through someone else's garden without permission? So, yeah, it's about honouring and respecting one another. And this issue of land and boundaries, I guess, is at the heart of what's going on in Gaza and Israel. Whose land is it? And who has the right to be there? Who polices the boundaries? Who creates the boundaries? I mean, look at the boundary between Israel and Gaza and the razor wire and the guards. And if you go within 300 meters, you're shot dead. I mean, that is the boundaries taken to the nth degree. And wouldn't it be nice to live in a world where there were no boundaries, where everyone's territory was respected? But if you can't respect other people's territory, then boundaries are required. That's when you get the gates and the barbed wire, and if they're not respected, things escalate. And I guess that's what's happened in the whole Israel-Gaza situation, where the things escalate and it's tit for tat. And if there are boundary violations, the boundaries just get bigger and stronger and more horrific until you've got guards with machine guns. And who wants to live in a world like that? So, yeah, wouldn't it be nice to live in a world where boundaries are respected? So that's kind of all I had to say, really. Just wanted to come out here and provide a little bit of an antidote to the narrative and all of the images and the videos that we're seeing of rockets and fire and horror and fear, and just present a bit of an alternative and possibly slightly more calming narrative. Sending you lots of love from a beautiful, peaceful Cressbrookdale. Bye for now.